So the question was, what settings do I use for speed light against the sun? We're going to use this image as an example, although it needed more speed light, but in this one I had tilted the head of the speed light upwards to avoid the illumination of the ground by the speed light. Because if you let it straight, it's going to illuminate the ground, and that's gonna look a little weird. I mean, the ground so illuminated, it looks a little unrealistic. Though in this one, there is another problem. I tilted the head upwards, the head of the speed light, which means I wasted 95% of its light. Only 5% goes on the face. The rest is just spread in the sky, right? So I'm gonna tell you how to deal with that. Now, in an image like that, we got three elements. Element number one is the sun, and we don't care about the sun because it's already white. How much white can it get? White is white, that's it. The element number two is the surroundings and background. The camera will take care of this in rear curtain flash. So set your flash rear curtain. Rear curtain means that the camera first exposes for the background, and when it's done, it flashes the speed light. Element number three, the face. For the face, it is a good practice, in order to avoid wasting your speed light by spreading it all around, zoom in the flash head and use TTL. Zoom in the flash head. Here are four shots where everything is identical except the flash head zoom, the 28 millimeter lens. When you put on a wide lens, the flash will automatically default to the wide lens, and it's gonna spread its light all around. And when you're outdoors, you don't care about that because the surroundings are already illuminated by the sun. You don't want more. You only care about the model. So at 28 millimeters, the flash head, and look how the exposure changes when I'm just zooming in the flash head. That's a significant difference. All right, now, in the lower right example where I zoomed in at 135 millimeter, just the flash head, there is more illumination, obviously, in the face. There is less on the edges, but we don't care about that because the sun outdoors is going to take care of that. Now, there are two reasons to shoot against the sun. The one is to use dark areas in order to create a sense of depth, dark and bright areas. The other reason is to get the starlight effect, which personally I don't like it to be that severe with the beams all over the image. To get that, you will use a closed aperture, such as f/16 here. As I say, I don't like it because the beams sometimes get over the skin and decolorize it funny. But you see these settings here. 200th of a second, f/16, ISO 200, and it's on TTL actually, strobe return. You see flash compulsory, strobe return. And higher ISO generally helps. Now, as far as the decoloration that the beams cause, which we can see in this image, where we have the decoloration of the face into something greenish-bluish, I also misfocused because the beam goes over it, and we have less light now here because I increased the speed to 500th of a second. So I wasted a lot of speed light, which flashed before and after the shutter opened and closed. See the previous video about that. So I wasted speed light at this shutter speed. So I would recommend not to go over 250 of a second if you're using one speed light. F16, ISO 500, whatever. Light metering mode, like matrix or sender weighted average or spot metering. And that's a big one because, to my knowledge, Nikon cameras will, let's say, adjust the sender weighted average according to the focus point, while many Canon cameras did not do that, the DSLRs. I do not know about the mirrorless models. So here we have an image with center weighted average. I told the camera to measure light mainly from the center. All right? So now I'm gonna turn the lens to the right, but I'm gonna maintain the focus on her face. Do you see that? The center weighted average focused around, measured around the focus point. So the camera measured the light around my intended point of focus and not from the center of the frame. This is something generally to know about Nikon cameras. However, there is another thing to consider when you're using center weight. And generally speaking, I don't use it as often as I use matrix. Look at these three images. This is with rear curtain flash. This is with slow flash. And this is with straight flash, no rear curtain. And all three of them look identical. Even the background looks identical. And you say, why is this happening? Well, because you limited the measurement, the light measuring of the camera in this area only, in the center. And there's just only one way to expose the center correctly, and the flash will fire either in the beginning or the end, doesn't make any difference. You pretty much canceled the light measuring from the surroundings, and you said the camera measure only the center. So there you have it. In this case, in this specific case, as you can see, rear curtain slow or straight flash yields the same result. Because the thing is that when your surroundings is a wide image with a wide lens, 28 millimeters in this case, if you use matrix metering to measure the entire frame and then to fire the flash, things may happen the opposite way of what you expected. For example, this is straight flash on the right, matrix metering straight flash, and this is matrix metering second curtain. And you would have assumed that the second curtain is the right picture because the background is exposed properly. But that's not the case, because in matrix metering the camera took into consideration the entire frame. And the entire frame is pretty dark, only this part is lit up. So it tried to expose correctly for the entire frame, which is 90% the room, while in this case the camera didn't care and it just happened to have the correct exposure, which would match pretty much the flash and the camera settings. So you have to consider that as well. And that is why I say, especially when you're using wide lenses, use center weighted average. And of course, each situation may be different, but these are your settings that you've been waiting for. And these are not set in stone, but they are an excellent starting point. Now, if you don't want starlight, you don't have to use such a closed aperture. Opening up the aperture, as a matter of fact, is going to give you better fall color bokeh, and you're going to have more available light for you from your flash too, right? And you don't need to zoom in the flash head if you're using a long lens. But what you need to do is to use a rear curtain shutter to make sure you're getting the background, because conditions will be different in each scene. So just put in rear curtain shutter for your flash and it's gonna work just fine. You're gonna get both the background and your subject perfectly. Why do I have the ISO in red? Because the ISO is the first thing that I'm thinking of changing every time I have underexposure from the flash. See, here I was a little further away. ISO 64. Somehow the flash was not enough, but I don't know why. Maybe I was, in the wrong spot. And this is ISO 400. Everything else is the same. And this is now an image that I can work with. And the next one was ISO 200, which is also fine. I mean, I can work with that as well. So after that, as you can see, I just kept the ISO at 200 and it worked pretty well. Now, something to keep in mind here, set the ISO manually because you cannot let it float when you're using TTL flash with Nikon. It won't float because it's got way too many parameters already. It's gonna stick where you set it. So set the ISO manually, and that's why I said 200. It's excellent for portraiture, outside in nature, for fill-in flash. And from there you can go up or down. And sometimes it depends on the circumstances too. In this case, for example, this is ISO 64. But the aperture is a little more open, 3.2. And I had a little more light in the shade. I had better light in the shade. This is a RAW file. These are all RAW files that I'm showing you. Now you cannot even compare this with the crap that the natural light photographers are doing when they're pushing up the shadows 4 stops on the face to compensate, right? Use flash. The older viewers have seen these examples. That's for the new viewers to point out some errors. This one I like. It can be printed as is. This is a RAW file straight from the camera. Manual focus, 55 millimeters, 1.8. The light is good. With flash, of course, remote flash that I was holding on my hands. The color and the density on the face is perfect. There is good color separation, blah, blah. The next one I exposed to the right, as they say, and now everything looks washed out, underexposed and flat. And the face is better than before, but the background is washed out. Compared to this, this looks more rich and more dimensional than this. Let's go here. 35 millimeters manual focus, 1.4. And I've given up 1.4 lately. Why? I'll show you why. She looks like she's out of focus, doesn't she? She's in focus. But at such high resolution, even half an inch difference in distance makes some things on her to look in focus, some to look slightly out of focus, and the whole result doesn't look as punchy as I want. This is also an underexposed image. 1600 speed. How the hell did I choose that? I didn't, the camera did. Because the background, if you print this, it's going to be so dark, it's going to be unacceptable. I mean, on the screen is back illuminated, looks fine, but this is much better. Again, RAW file, like all the previous ones. 1,000th of a second, I reduced the speed, I let more light in. And now the aperture is 1.8. And she looks more sharp, right? And the color density on the face and the colors and everything, perfect. Straight out of camera RAW files. Okay? So this is much better. Maybe I could put a half a stop more in the background. That would be a much better idea. Because I want the background to appear more alive in the print. Now compare the images that I just showed you with the so-called natural light photographers. And you can print mine, but you cannot print those that are not with a flash. Look at this middle one that says Master Natural Backlight. These are not skin colors. This is leathery brown. If you print this, if you print it, I mean, I dare you to print it as it is, it's going to be completely toneless, completely dead. The same for the one that says how to edit golden hour portraits. This is horrible. It will look like there's something wrong with the printer. It looks like images that are left on the old magnetic acidic albums and their colors faded and was corrupted in time. Where the images, on the other hand, that use flash, and there are a few where the photographer used flash, like this one here that says BTS 19 Golden Hour Portraits. Seems like he used a pretty good flash too, a professional, the Godox AD400. They look a lot better, even after this heavy fashionable editing that makes everybody look like a CGI, and I don't really agree with it. But wherever flash is used, you can tell. There's vibrant colors, pictures that are alive and are pleasant to look. And not like that hipsterish, melancholic, weird thing that I see sometimes, oh God almighty, where everything looks orange. Now here's an important thing about color that I have not seen anybody mentioning yet. This is a straight out of camera image from the Z7 with the flash, with the kit zoom lens that it came at the time, 24-70 f/4. This is at 4.5, 1/60th of a second, blah blah. At any rate, I used the Joe McNally modifier, that small portable light box, in order to smoothen out the shadows. They look a lot better now, and to smoothen out the overall contrast. And straight out of camera, it looks really nice, right? Because without flash, that's without flash. And we were very lucky because the sun was shining on her face behind clouds. And that was the perfect softbox effect, right? But even in this case, there is significant more contrast at the edges that I would need to smoothen out before printing. Otherwise, the darker areas are going to be printed even darker, and it's going to look a lot harsher. But then I noticed that there is a yellowish coloration on her face, and that was a mystery. And then the mystery was solved when I saw this image. Because here we are illuminated through the Joe McNally softbox with a flash, and my skin tone looks more natural than hers. And that's because of the makeup. So there is something to be said about makeup artists, right? So check whether a certain brand or a certain color of makeup can affect the colors on the face to look more yellowish. Now, of course, the problem with flash photography is that you have to learn another device, and the Japanese people do not really make it easy. They're not plug and play like the Americans. It's like you have to go to university to study the acronyms on the flash. I mean, it's like you tell them, hi, I would like a device to help me type a text. And they come up with this, you know. And then we have the compact cameras, of course, with the flash, the ones that come with the flash. And they are guaranteed by the manufacturer, I mean almost guaranteed in my experience, to get a really good shot for fill-in flash in daylight between 2.5 to 6 meters, and for a straight flash up to, let's say, 5 meters. And it's a really good deal because some of them are crop sensor size with excellent image quality and interchangeable lenses. Here's an important note for these compact cameras with a flash. If you're planning to use second curtain flash to expose the background correctly as well, or almost correctly, stabilization is essential. Because if the background is darker, the camera will use a lower shutter speed to expose for the background and then fire the flash. And that is why I could not be convinced with these compact Fuji, very expensive fixed lens cameras. If they have no stabilization, then I cannot use a second curtain flash in many situations. The shutter speed will be too low and the image will be shaken. I took this in 2003 in October, a JPEG straight out of the Canon camera, and I sent it to NBC News and they displayed it. They chose a few images from the viewers and they displayed it. So with this image, I'm closing and I'm wishing you good success in your October photographs. Thanks a lot. Bye.